That was creepy. The door just opened. Okay. All right. Hello, my lovelies, and welcome back to my channel. I'm Heather, and this is The Happenings with H.A.P. H.A.P. meaning my initials. It is now officially August. August 2nd to be precise, and it is time to share my July reading wrap up. I read a lot of books this July. I'm actually kind of shocked by how many books I've read this month because it's more than I read in May when I was still in lockdown, which is kind of crazy. Granted, we did have the reading rush at the end of July, and I read 3 books during that, and that fulfilled all of the challenge requirements for it. If you are interested in seeing my Reading Rush vlog, you can click up here. So it was a good reading month. I was able to knock out an entire series that I've been wanting to read for years, as well as a few other books. And yeah, all in all, it was a pretty solid reading month for sure. Before we get into the video, if you are new here, hello, welcome. I hope that I'm entertaining for you. If you are returning, thank you so much for your support. If you haven't yet, please like and subscribe down below. As always, I appreciate the support that I've received from everyone in the book community. So thank you so much. Now let's get on to my July reads. So the first book I'll talk about is the first book I actually finished during the reading rush, and that is Avatar: The Last Airbender, North and South. This was another of the comic volume bind-ups that I've been reading, and it dealt with Katara and Sokka returning back home to the Southern Water Tribe and finding out that everything has changed, and the Northern Water Tribe is kind of starting to impose a lot of their type of government systems and all that onto the Southern Water Tribe, and it kind of becomes this sort of battle between wanting to preserve a culture and wanting to change it. I guess it's kind of a little bit of comment on gentrification in a way. So that's interesting. I just thought of that now. I did speak about this more in depth because I commented on it as I was reading it during my reading vlog. Again, if you're interested, it is up in the cards. So I'm not gonna go too far into it in this video, but I really enjoyed it. It was not my favorite. The Search, as I keep saying, The Search is still my favorite. I've yet to read one that's topped that one, but definitely enjoyed it. As I mentioned in my August TBR, I'm hoping to read the last 2 bind-ups that I have. And I believe that there's another one as well, either on deck being published, I'm not sure. But I definitely want to keep reading them and finishing the series because it's so good and I've really been enjoying it and I highly recommend. The next book that I finished for the reading rush was The Poet X by Elizabeth Acevedo. I've wanted to read this for a bit. I heard a lot of great things about it over the years on BookTube. But what really pushed me to read this one was I read Pride by E.B. Zaboy back in June, and Elizabeth Acevedo actually performed the audiobook, and I adored the way she presented that story, so I was really looking forward to a story that she wrote herself. This is actually her debut novel, and it is a novel in verse. It was something different for me. I don't typically enjoy poetry. Like, I can enjoy it as the art form that it is, but I'm not usually one to seek it out, if that makes sense. Especially slam poetry. Like, if I see a really great one on Facebook, I'll probably repost it because I liked it, but it's not something I would probably actively go see. It's just, I don't know, it's just not. And Elizabeth Acevedo is actually a slam poetry writer, speaker, what have you, artist, performer. There's a lot of words. And her performance of her own work obviously was wonderful. I really loved how at the end she kind of goes into this poetry structure that ends up happening at the end of the book, and it's really well done. And even listening to it, except for the last few pages, where she kind of goes over this poetic structure that she kind of created, I didn't feel like I was really listening to a poem, if that makes sense. It was really well done. It definitely told a story. The story follows Xiomara. She's a high school teenager who lives in Harlem. She's Afro-Latina, just like Elizabeth Acevedo is. So this is an own voices novel. Basically, it goes over her relationship with her mother, as well as her relationship with religion and her idea of identity and how to properly express her own voice. And she does that through poetry. I will say that I didn't love this book. I gave gave it 3.5 stars. The writing was beautiful. Like I said, the performance of the audiobook was also wonderful. I felt that these were very realized characters. It was very short. It was only about 3.5 hours. So there wasn't much to grab onto. Like, I don't want to say nothing happens, because Ziamara's mother is extremely, extremely religious, to the point where she basically tells her kids that she always wanted to be a nun and she doesn't really love their father, and she kind of got coerced into that marriage, and she doesn't even want Ziamara to, like, you know, to even talk to boys, and she ends up actually punishing her in very, like, horrible ways. Like, her mother is straight up abusive, especially psychologically and emotionally, a little bit physically too. So that was kind of for personal reasons, I'll get into this, I guess. I was raised Catholic, so I'm not Catholic anymore. Usually if you're raised it, you either stay it or you don't. And I'm especially not really a huge fan of organized religion. So the mother already seems like a villainous character, and the awful thing she does to her children is just, it's just terrible. And I know that this is a comment on religious households. It's a comment on Latinx households as well sometimes. So I get that, and I totally understand where that was coming from. But aside from that, not much happens. Ziamara meets Aman, who is a boy in her science class, and they start kind of seeing each other on the down low, and they end up making out on a train, and her mom sees and flips the hell out and ends up doing something really awful. But after that, the resolution is so quick. There was this awful thing that happened, but then they go to counseling and it's fine. And maybe that's realistic for some people. I guess I'm more of a pessimist, and I just don't find that very realistic. And I wanted more of a beginning, middle, end structure with more of a conflict, because it didn't really go many places. And that could be also because of the style of writing that it is, which is totally fair. Like I said, I can definitely appreciate the artistic merits, and I'm very interested in reading her other novels, but I just didn't really connect with this one. And I think it was more because of the stylization than anything else. It wasn't bad in an artistic way, but it wasn't my favorite this month. It was probably my, like I said, I gave it 3.5, which I believe was the same as what I gave Avatar Last Year, but in North and South. So it was fine. I probably won't read it again. It's that type of thing. Like, I'm glad I could read it. I'm glad I added it to my reading repertoire for the year, but it just didn't really hit home for me, unfortunately. The last book that I read for the reading rush was The Body by Stephen King. This fulfilled the challenge in the reading rush for reading a book of a movie you've already seen. The Body is actually the inspiration for the film Stand By Me. This is the third Stephen King book that I've read so far. I've read The Shining, Dr. Sleep, and now this. And I've definitely realized, though I knew after reading the first two books that I read of his, that I am really a huge fan of his writing. His characters are just so fully realized, and his worlds are fully realized. If you've ever seen the film Stand By Me, you honestly don't even really need to read the book, because it is pretty much the same almost entirely. Like, there are some deviations and some things cut for time, but the book is a novella, so it is very short, and pretty much everything that happens in the film happens in the book, like verbatim almost. And having read it and knowing that this existed obviously before the film, the casting that they did for that film was spectacular. I've always been a fan of it. I mean, I was a kid when it came out, so of course I had a crush on River Phoenix when it came out. And his portrayal of Chris was so much in line with the character from the book. Like, all of them were, like, obviously having seen the film first, that informed how I viewed the characters, but man, they were so perfectly cast. But like I said, the book is basically the same. There is a couple of deviations. There's more of Gordy, the main character, speaking of his writings. I believe that there's a deviation from what happens to them when they depart, because they go into way more depth in that than I remember in the film. But overall, I really enjoyed it. I gave it, I gave it four stars, and it was really great. I'm glad I actually read it now I know. But yeah, definitely a good one for sure. So as I said in the beginning, I actually ended up finishing an entire series this month, and it was one I was meaning to read for years. And that is the Stalking Jack the Ripper series by Kerri Maniscalco. And the series as a whole includes Stalking Jack the Ripper, Hunting Prince Dracula, Escaping from Houdini, the novella Becoming the Dark Prince, and the last book Capturing the Devil. I really loved this series. This made its way into my favorite series list for sure. It is a historical fiction that follows Audrey Rose Wadsworth and Thomas Cresswell, who are budding forensic students to Audrey Rose's uncle, and they attempt to solve the Jack the Ripper murders. What I really loved about these books, and it's kind of a spoiler, but not really because it literally happens in the early part of the first book, was the relationship between Audrey Rose and Thomas. I fell in love with Thomas Cresswell. Oh my God. They're such a wonderful couple. Like, they rank in the Will Herondale and Tessa Gray level of awesomeness as a couple. So because this book begins around the time period of the Jack the Ripper murders, that means that this book takes place in the late 19th century. And obviously women were not able to do what they could do now. If you went in the medical field back then, you would most likely be a nurse more than anything else. You wouldn't be a doctor. You would not for sure be a forensic detective or coroner or anything like that. And Audrey Rose is one of those women characters that is very happy being girly. She loves pretty things. She loves to look nice, but she also really finds science fascinating. She really loves working with the dead. It's the best way I can describe it. And she's incredibly smart. But what I loved about her is that she was not a Mary Sue at all. She has flaws. She has doubts. She's not perfect. She can be blindsided. She can be naive. But she's so smart. She's such a fun character. And the banter between her and Thomas is just perfection. I adored it. I listened to the audiobook for these and I was literally laughing out loud at a lot of their back and forth quips. And yes, it's supposed to be 19th century romance, so you think Victorian, you think sitting next to each other, not touching and whatnot, but they are such little dirty kids. Like, Thomas's innuendos about everything was so wonderful. It was just so fun. Like, the banter was so good. And this romance is a very slow burn. Slow burn. But slow burn in a wonderful way. Because you know they're always going to be endgame, but yet there's all these kind of obstacles, and they are young characters. They both are 17 when the book starts. I know, I'm going on and on about this pairing, but I just absolutely adored it. Like I said, it's one of my favorite pairings I've read in a while. As for the series themselves, based on the titles, you probably think that it's more of like villain of the week type of deal, but they're actually not. It is one full flow storyline and takes place over the span of just like 6 months. So a lot happens to these characters in 6 months. So from here on, it's going to be a bit spoilery, but I'm not going to try to reveal too much. But Stalking Jack the Ripper, obviously they are trying to uncover the Jack the Ripper murders. In Hunting Prince Dracula, both Audrey Rose and Thomas go to an academy in Romania where they are looking to study forensic science and forensic medicine. And it's kind of like I don't want to say auditing, but it is kind of like auditing like a course before they're fully accepted. And they get wrapped up in the lore of Prince Dracula because killings happen. And then after that, in book 3, Escaping from Houdini, they have to go with Audrey's uncle to America in order to work on this case. So they go on this ship, the Etheria, and there is this midnight carnival that's on there, and more murders start to happen on the ship. Audrey Rose kind of gets involved with the character of Mephistopheles, who is the ringmaster of this carnival. And so there's a bit of a love triangle thing going on there. And their banter too, their interactions were really great. And then in Becoming the Dark Prince, the novella that's between the third and fourth books, you get Thomas's point of view for the last bit of Escaping from Houdini. The rest of the series is actually in Audrey Rose's perspective. That's where kind of the more concrete romance parts happen. And then in Capturing the Devil, we actually go into the H.H. Holmes murders in Chicago during the World's Fair. So yeah, all this happens in a span of 6 months, and it's a lot. So sometimes things can be a little bit unbelievable. Not all the books are as strong as the others, but there are points in the books that are all amazing. All these books received between 4 and 4.5 stars, so they were all very high, and I absolutely love them all, and I love the whole storyline that ran through them. What I also really loved is the amount of historical detail that Kerri Maniscalco went into to write these books. At the end of each one, she gives this whole author's note about where she took some liberties and what inspired her to create other things. And there's a lot that went into it that is pretty historically accurate to the period. And I love that level of detail with historical fiction, because obviously a lot of what happens wasn't true, but a lot of it is. And it's the kind of historical fiction I like to read. It's also the kind of historical fiction whenever I write it, I like to write where, you know, you really try to be as accurate as possible and embellish where needed, but not just to make it ridiculous. So again, I really loved this series, and it was a fun mystery. So there is a villain in each one, obviously, but you're not sure as the reader where it's gonna go. For a while, I think it's one character and then it turns out to be another. And I know the Jack the Ripper case, I know the H.H. Holmes cases, I also know about Houdini and his background, so like I have a sense of what has happened historically, which made it more fun to try to figure out what's going on. And especially because the Jack the Ripper cases were never solved, that makes it fun to play around with. My least favorite of all of them was probably Hunting Prince Dracula, just because that's where it got a wee bit ridiculous, but it still did not delve into supernatural things or fantasy or anything like that. It still was very much grounded in realism and facts. And one thing I really loved too was, another spoiler, Audrey Rose does get injured in the course of the series. She takes a knife to her leg and she ends up having a permanent limp and has to use a cane. And Kerri Maniscalco actually said this was a choice because she actually has disability, and she wanted to write a character that also had disabilities for more representation. And I just think that's really awesome, because Audrey Rose deals with this fact, you know, Thomas and her family deals with this fact of her injury, but she never loses who she is. She's never defined by that disability, and I just think that's really awesome to have that kind of representation. Because as I was reading it, and you know, it happened, and then the aftermath of it, and I wasn't even thinking about it really, because I was just like, Audrey's freaking awesome, she's a great character. So then when I heard the author's note, I'm just like, oh wow. So that's like how representation should be, like you don't really notice it. And I did wonder in the beginning stages of the book, Thomas's character is very Sherlockian in ways, in that he very much can turn on the cold exterior. He's also not too adept at social cues. And I was wondering when I was reading it if perhaps he actually had a form of maybe Asperger's or autism or somewhere on the spectrum. I'm not sure. She never mentions it in an author's note, but it was something to note just because of some of his social faux pas were very obvious, and the way he's able to notice details and point out things and make deductions, as Audrey likes to say, would kind of hint at that. So you could almost read this as Thomas being on the spectrum if you really wanted to, because there's kind of evidence in it to back that up, even if Kerri Maniscalco didn't say that. I don't want to put words in her mouth if she honestly didn't try to do that, but it was just something I noticed and I thought was very interesting. Did not take away at all, not that it ever should, of Thomas's lovability. Like, I know people fall in love with book characters, book boyfriends, but man, Thomas is up there now for me. I absolutely adore him. He's so cheeky, he's so naughty, but he's so sweet, and he constantly feels that he's not good enough for Audrey Rose and constantly tells her that he doesn't want her to be anything but herself for him. And it's what every type of relationship should be, and is not, and it's sad. I will take this over any terrible toxic relationship any day. Love it. So yeah, this series definitely went into my favorite series of all time list for sure. So that's it. Those are all the books that I read in the month of July. It was a total of 8 books, which was more than in June, which is pretty wild. So I feel each month I keep reading more, and I've been back at work, so I'm very surprised at that. But I really wanted to finish the Stalking Jack the Ripper series, so I really breezed through them really quick. But I absolutely adored them. I really did enjoy everything I read this month, and I'm very excited for next month. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let me know what you guys read in July, and have you read any of these books? Are you hoping to read, are some of the books that I read on your TBR? Because if you've read them, I would love to talk about them and gush, because I really enjoyed them. Anyway, I hope you guys have a great week, and I will see you in my next video. Bye. August 2nd to be Stalking the Jack. Oh. Mephistopheles. What did you guys read during the a little bit involved with the character with Mephistopheles?